In this section, I'm going to show you how to create a new WinCC version 8 project. We'll also take a look at the properties of the project and the server. So let's get started. Okay, we're going to start by creating our first project, and we'll go to the WinCC Explorer icon that is on the desktop and just double click, and WinCC will come up. Now, if I've never created a project on this machine before, we will see this dialog asking us which type of project we would like to create. If this doesn't come up, you can just do File, New, and you get the same thing. A single user project is a project that's going to be on one computer. It doesn't really have any thick clients. A multi-user project is when you are configuring WinCC client server, and a client project is when you are in a multi-server environment where there's several WinCC applications and you want to create a shell project to receive information from all of them. And of course, you can just open and browse to an existing project. We're going to create a single user project and just click OK. Now, by default, your project path is the public path of your users directory under public documents, Siemens WinCC projects. Of course, you can change this if you want. We're going to give our project a name, and it only allows certain characters. It won't allow you, say, to do a space. And we're going to call this WinCC V8 SBS for step by step. And we're going to click the create button. After a few moments, WinCC will have created the project. And if you've seen past versions of WinCC, you'll notice that they've changed the icons, and you can kind of minimize these or do the medium level icons or large icons if you like. Let me show you around the editor. So the first thing is the very top node is going to be the name of our project. If we do right click properties, you'll see the properties dialog. And for the general tab, this is your project type. So you can change this from a single user project to multi-user just by making a selection, and then it'll tell you to close the project and reopen it. And then it'll be a multi-user project. We can add our own version. This is really just a text field, so we'll just call this version 1. And we can add a comment, and as we make changes, we can use this commentary field to keep track of the changes. For update cycles, these are all the update cycles that the tag manager uses when you add tags to screens. In WinCC, the update cycle is not a property of the tag, it's a property of a tag connection to, say, a graphic object or something. And they have all the time cycles you might expect. There's also an upon change, which is kind of good to use. And then there's 5 user cycles where you can create your own cycle. And the good part about this is if you create a cycle and it's too fast, then you can come to one place and change it without going to everywhere that you used it. So more about this when we talk about Graphics Designer. On shortcuts, this is where you can do some project level shortcuts. So if I want a log on dialog, I could just hit a keystroke in here and hit assign. It would give me a log on. We'll use this when we're talking about user administrator. Hard copy just creates a screenshot and prints it. And then there's also some system dialogs that you can get to if you want to make a shortcut. Under options, these are kind of various options that have to do with the project. Basically about your runtime language, how you export text files as ASCII or Unicode, things like that. And under operating mode, you can run WinCC as a service versus a standard. And if you run it in standard, then that means someone has to be logged on to the operating system in order to run the project. If the user logs off, then it shuts the project down. And this is not acceptable for certain industries, oil and gas and things like that. And you can run it as a service and you just give it an account to run under. Now you're going to notice if you do run it as a service that no one has to be logged on. And also there is no graphics runtime on the server. You would be seeing that on your client systems. You would also see it on WebUX or Web Navigator, but you would not have a local runtime. It would actually be disabled. Under user interface and design, this is a good feature to kind of minimize development time. On your active design, you have several ones that are locked, and then you can also create your own. You can just kind of pick one that you want and make a copy of it. But basically, this allows you to select different objects and define exactly how they look so that when you add them to screens, they're already configured and you have kind of a user interface that conforms to this design. And we're going to see when we get into Graphics Designer that there's a property on pretty much every object that is whether or not it's subscribed subscribes to the current local design or not. And before you can make changes, you have to set that to no. So we'll see that when we get into graphics designer. So this is really just a good way to kind of enforce a policy of how buttons and text and other objects look on your user interface. And then we also have a standard palette. What the standard palette does for us is it allows us to create a standard palette based on numbers, and we can use these colors and reference them on our screens. The good thing about it is if we make a change to it, then it will automatically change it everywhere it's used. So instead of having to go everywhere we use that particular shade of red, you could change it from the standard palette and it would work. And you can have multiple palettes. So again, this is a development tool to kind of make your integration team a lot more efficient. So I'll cancel out of the project properties, and under the computer properties, this is our computer. Now in version 8, we can double click this, and the computer properties have been added to the Configuration Studio to make things a lot easier. And so we can select this computer, and then all of our different properties are here in the detail screen. So if you've used WinCC before, this Configuration Studio is used for a lot of the different editors to give it the same look and feel. This is a really nice interface. So here we can change our cursor controls, some Windows hotkeys, which design settings we're using, also your main runtime window, does it have a title, border, things like that. We can set this information here. I can also get to the older property setting just by doing right-click properties. And if you've used WinCC before, this is also familiar. So they've kind of given it to you in two different ways. And we're going to be coming back to this interface as we create our demo project and get familiar with it. But very quickly, under our startup tab, this is where you select the WinCC services that you're running in runtime. So if you configure alarms, you want to come in and turn on alarm logging runtime so it works. Same thing with tag logging, global script and things like that. Under parameters, we can disable hotkeys to keep the operator out of the operating system while we're in runtime. We set our time zone, also the new REST interface that we're going to be covering later, and graphics runtime, what our start picture is, menus and toolbars, and attributes of our base UI screen. So we'll definitely come back to that. And also we have the ability to run debuggers and define different cursors that are used based on the types of actions that are configured. You also have your monitor keyboard here. So if you have a monitor that you're showing WinCC screens on and there's no keyboard or mouse there, then if you enable your monitor keyboard, then when the user interacts, say with an IO field or whatever, it'll show the appropriate keyboard. Okay, so now we have successfully created a new project. We can move on to the next topic, which will cover connecting to your process.